States, all of them are still active. To give you a sense of the ways in which the religious exemptions or the religious excuses come into play, I have a few examples up here. One, the Knight versus Connecticut, it was the Department of Public Health, was a case involving a nurse who was in charge of home health care services, and she went to make sure everything, you know, she would visit patients' homes to make sure everything was going well. She visited the home of a same-sex couple, one of whom was in the last stages of AIDS, and she took it upon herself to let him know he was going to hell, apparently very soon, and proselytizing to him and his partner. They complained, she was fired, and she said, that's a violation of my religious freedom. The Lupita Benitez case was out in California, and she, there was only one in-network provider of fertility services in this Lupita's plan, and they would not provide fertility services to a same-sex couple based on a religious belief. The Jennifer Keaton case was a case where involving a student who was getting her master's in counseling, and she had made comments in class at Augusta State University indicating that she would not be able to counsel someone who was LGBT because it was against her religious beliefs, and she would refer them out after she told them that they were going to hell and that, that what they were doing was against God. The school said, you can't do that. That's against the code of ethics for professionals. You agreed when you came to the school that the curriculum, you followed the curriculum, which incorporated the code of ethics, and they put her on a remediation plan to make sure that she learned about the LGBT community and her responsibility to treat them with dignity. She refused to do that, and when she was released from the program, she sued and claimed a religious exemption. The vacation lodging, some folks with same-sex couple were denied bed and breakfast. Aloha bed and breakfast said that they did not allow their types. A number of employment discrimination cases, one of which involved a employee who didn't believe in the diversity program, so he put all kinds of posters up in response that talked about the Christian view that there's that homosexuality was sinful. He was fired. He sued. We do have a child placement case. The Catholic Charities organization was their contract to place children was rescinded when an anti-discrimination law was passed. And then the Odgard case is it's not even a church. It was a former church that the proprietors decided they were going to deny access, even though it was open to everyone else in a beautiful event space, not for same-sex couples. So we want all of these cases, not we being Lambda Legal, but we being the lawyers who brought the cases and the plaintiffs, et cetera. But RFRA was not involved in any of these. They brought religious claims under the First Amendment, under Title VII, which is a federal law that says an employer can't discriminate, has to give you a reasonable accommodation for your religious belief. But I want to sort of maybe circle back and talk about what would happen if there was a RFRA or FATA in place. But that's the way in which people will use religious excuses. So it's just sort of a sampling, an illustration of the way this can come into play and hurt people. Anti-transgender bills do are just these harmful, awful bills targeting the transgender community, denying them access to appropriate facilities, sex-segregated facilities. Some of them criminalize the use of bathrooms, and many of them are targeted at students in schools. Here's what that looks like in terms of representation. What I call miscellaneous meanness. We've got all kinds of, not as many, but bills that prohibit taxpayer money towards marriage for same-sex couples, impose criminal sanctions. South Carolina says the Supreme Court doesn't tell them what to do. The preemption one is a really scary type of bill, legislation that has been introduced and passed in some states last year, not this year, but I understand North Carolina is considering a special session to pass what's called a preemption bill, which basically says local anti-discrimination laws are no good, that you have to follow the state's anti-discrimination categories. You can't, that local municipalities and cities can't expand that to include sexual orientation. These are really scary because all of the ways in which we can combat RFRA in the private setting is anti-discrimination laws. And if we don't have those, it's gonna be a lot harder. So there you go, I won't go through the others. This is kind of a map of all the legislation, 33 states, I think, in which there is active legislation targeting the LGBT community. So it's serious, it's widespread, and hopefully this has been a sobering look at what's kind of ahead of us. As you can see, the South quite a lot. You think, look, Texas is doing awesome. This really, who knew they were so progressive? That was last year. It took care of this a long time ago, apparently. I don't want to leave the sort of umbrella without mentioning voter suppression, because laws that suppress the ability to vote affect LGBT people. They disproportionately impact people of color, who are young, who are transgender, who are low income, and why, you know, this matters to all of us for lots of social justice reasons. But in terms of our community, a third of our community are people of color who are affected, potentially affected by the inability to be represented in democracy. LGBT people are almost twice as likely to live in poverty. So despite the myth of white and affluent male, gay, great with a great style or something, apparently in reality, we all know that's not exactly the case. And in fact, a lot of folks in our community fall into the category of people who are affected by voter suppression laws. We have more people who are young, self-identified LGBT people who are young, who are affected by these laws. And transgender folks, we know, of course, are targeted in terms of voter suppression laws because of the way they impact their identity documents, which is a grand shame because transgender folks are more likely to vote as compared to other folks. And so targeting them, and all these. So I can't go through any kind of anti-LGBT legislation without talking about voter suppression as well. Great. So thank you for letting me roll through that to give you an idea of what's happening. I now want to sort of turn it over to you guys and then to you guys to talk about, take a look at like a case study in terms of the work that you've been doing around anti-LGBT legislation. What's worked, what hasn't worked, what ideas do you have? What can we do to make sure that these don't become laws?
May I please?
Oh.
Y'all means I. Mm-hmm. Not you guys.
Not sure what's happening. I feel like we're going to the prom.
Language is so important.
Y'all means all. Did I say you-ins or something?
You said guys.
Oh, did I?
I'm offended.
My bad.
Really.
All right, now we got back. Thank you.
We're talking about language and how it's important, right? Y'all, language is important. You believe language is important, raise the roof. All right.
If you're mad at me for saying you guys, I'm sorry.
Teaching and learning.
All right, who wants to start? Crystal? You ready?
Sure. Did you want to start? I feel like you were on the schedule, but I can totally dive in.
Doesn't matter to me.
Okay. All right. So again, my name is Crystal Richardson, and I work with Equality North Carolina. So I will talk to you today about how all of the stuff that's happening across the country when it comes to RFRA, and I've been saying FADA, the First Amendment Defense Act, how that type of legislation will or can impact North Carolina. I just want to start with saying that I live in Charlotte, and for the past year and a half or so, I've been working with many community leaders and folks across the state to get non-discrimination protections in Charlotte. And we were able to pass that fairly recently. And what those protections covered was vehicles for hire, city contracts, the city's human relations committee, which, you know, if you have a grievance, you can report it, they'll investigate it, and if there's an issue, they'll handle it or potentially give you a claim, a right to sue letter, and then public accommodations. So before I dive in, I just really want to give you some background as to where we started and, you know, what does it look like when you have a group of people that come together and say we want more protections in our locality? What do we need to do? Where do we start? So for us, luckily, we have a great deal of community leaders who are really good friends with city council members. And when I say friends, meaning they attend regular city council meetings, they attend city council members' events, and have gotten to know and kind of check the pulse of where city council is on these issues. And I think that's one of the most important things you can do. You definitely need to know about the ins and outs of the laws, but I think making the connections is the best way to start and really identify who has those connections. So once we were able to start there, our person that helped us, his name is Scott Bishop. He was a chair of the local PAC, which is MECPAC, particularly focusing on, you know, electing candidates and endorsing candidates that are LGBTQ friendly or at least aware of our issues that we could work with, and also a part of an organization called the Human Rights Campaign. And so in working with Scott, he reached out to groups like Equality North Carolina, the LGBT Chamber, which was then known as the Charlotte Business Guild, the LGBT Democrats, the Law Cabin Republicans, just different groups to really see who, you know, kind of taking stock of who is available to help us work on this ordinance. And so in that, we were able to identify a person that could really go through the statutes and see where we can add these protections. And so just looking across North Carolina very broadly, there wasn't a city that had the types of protections that we were trying to pass. You can start looking in what many of you probably already know if you're an attorney, or even if you're not, but Muni Code website's a free website where you can look at all statutes for all cities and look and see. There's a search box. You can look and see what non-discrimination protections are already there. And generally, to get these protections for the LGBT community, it's just a matter of adding to the language. Not saying that's always the case, but majority of the time, that's what folks are doing. And so adding the language, gender identity and sexual orientation to a non-discrimination ordinance that includes things like race, religion, sex, that sort of thing. And so using great websites with information like Lambda Legal, even I brought the HRC's Municipal Equality Index in here, looking at North Carolina, there's some protections in cities and counties, including Greensboro, Asheville, there's various other different areas, Raleigh, Durham, Chapel Hill, Fayetteville, but most of that is for your public employees. So what do we do as private citizens? How do we get change for us if we're not a city employee or a county employee? So that's kind of where we were looking at. Where do we add these protections? And so we just looked at every single statute and identified all of them and then really started to develop a relationship with the city attorney and the city manager, because a lot of this stuff is policy-based, but we also had to make sure we had the legal authority to do this. And so also looking at the state constitution was very key. Having, and this is where kind of taking stock of who in your coalition has which expertise, you know, who can look at a state constitution and some of the state statutes and see whether a city or a municipality has this authority. And so, and able to talk to the city attorney about what this is, why it's needed, and to do the research. We worked with a legislative expert in D.C. with HRC as well, and she was even able to get on the phone a couple of times with the city attorney. And I would say a couple months before we were able to try this for the first time in Charlotte, Greensboro tried some similar protections, and those two city attorneys were able to get on the phone and talk about the legal authority. Not saying that's always the best way. That could have turned out really horrifically, but I think being able to have someone to bounce those ideas, to give the folks in leadership the confidence that, you know, we have backing in case there is some backlash, and I'll talk about that in a minute. But just to speed up, so we realized that not all of the protections that we wanted to pass, we would be able to, for example, housing. If you look at Charlotte City Charter, which is also an issue when we think about preemption, what authority the state gives a city or a municipality to pass these types of laws, and how is the city's charter written, can you do this? And that's where, like I said, either having someone who really knows these statutes and laws or an attorney that you can consult with will really be key. And we realized, you know, Greensboro, I think their city charter was able, it was written a little differently, and they were able to contact the federal government and to update their housing laws to include gender identity and sexual orientation, where in Charlotte, that was one of the things we had to let go. So I bring all that up because, you know, I know a lot of the media has boiled this down to just a bathroom issue, but it really does include all of the things I mentioned before. And we also looked at different things, and I know other cities added to their non-discrimination ordinance things like veteran status. We were able to add marital status and familial status. So if you have folks, you know, single dads with their daughters, or single moms with their sons, or folks who are caregivers, it really lends to a whole group of people that really aren't being talked about because the opposition is so loud about this trans bathroom issue. So that's one thing. The other thing is, you know, the first time we tried this was in March of 2015, and you know, and like I said, we had folks who really had strong relationships with our city council members, and even in continuing the conversation with them, providing them resources, because a lot of times they don't know where to go. You know, they might not know about Protect Thy Neighbor or the MEI. So you have to be in constant contact with them, checking in sometimes 2 to 3 times a week, but at least, you know, weekly to say, what do you need? Where are we at in your discussion? Sometimes it's showing up. We had to do a couple dinner meetings where, you know, normally you aren't able to present, but you can kind of be there as a support to answer questions. And a lot of times when it comes to LGBTQ issues, you know, city manager and city council members might not always have the language, even though they really do want to help. So, you know, just being there and saying, I'm a resource, being in the room and being visible, there's lots of media there. Having signs, and you know, you can't really have folks advocating for you if you aren't showing up and saying, I care about this issue. And I tell you, we packed that place out. It's probably the most heavily attended city council member in Charlotte history, meeting in Charlotte history. But anyway, so just showing up in March and the time it took to even get them to put this on the agenda to vote and really staying engaged with city council members and all folks involved was a challenge, and we really thought, you know, we had the votes, and then we get up there the day of, you lose one person, and then you lose the entire thing. So I think we lost last year, the vote was 6-5. So then we go back to the drawing board. Well, then the question becomes, how do you keep people engaged? That was a really hurtful and painful event to go through. I mean, I sat through 4 hours of people telling me, you know, and I'm a Christian. I mean, it was really, that was the first time I've ever been in an environment where I saw people from the Christian community be so hateful and so mean. And to see, you know, just the spew of hate, and to get up the next day and support other people and figure out, you know, how do we go back to the drawing board? How do we keep people moving forward? It's really a challenge, even for myself. But, you know, we do it, and we do it together. And so, in that, you think about the lessons learned, you pay attention to what's happening all across the country. Since then, I've seen lots of these types of bills pop up in places like Georgia, South Dakota, and, you know, just all over. And you're watching and you're thinking, gosh, you know, is there ever going to be hope where we can have these types of non-discrimination protections and not be viewed as this, you know, kind of odd group of people just fighting for extra protections when you're just trying to live your life? So you find ways to share your story and to keep folks accountable. Because, like I said, we lost some people at city council. So then it got to a point where we said, you know what, voting does matter. And you talked about voter suppression. So now we need to get our people out to vote. We need to see who we can get on council, who are pro-equality candidates. And so we formed a coalition called Turnout Charlotte, which was the local group that Scott started, MCPAT. And then we added Equality North Carolina and the Human Rights Campaign. And we really had to sit down and think about, you know, which groups of people can we target. So we did everything from phone banks to action alerts to mailers, really tried to generate that visibility, which I think was really key. We'll be having a caucus later, I think from 6 to 8, about passing non-discrimination ordinance in other cities, including Asheville. But so I don't want to spill too much of that. But I do want to say that, you know, it took a great deal of resources and trust and to be able to really allow, you know, folks who are good at certain areas to do that. We really leaned on some of the national groups to help us with pushing out mailers and messaging and content and that sort of thing and creating the space so we could have phone banks. Then we depended on the local people to drive people to these phone banks and to staff them and to be at rallies and to be at the press conferences. We leaned on the business community. We leaned on the faith community. We leaned on visibility of people of color and trans folks and really tried to show the folks that were sitting on council and in the community, you know, you're saying that we don't need these protections, but I'm showing you why we do. These are people sharing their stories. And so you need kind of the facilitators or those bridge, those liaisons of people, which I think Turnout Charlotte was that group of facilitating between the on the grounds folks, because you need that visibility. So to show that awareness, but also you need the folks who are in leadership to say, hey, I might not be ready to come out on this, but can I ask you a few questions? Can you give me some resources? And it may take years. I mean, this is something I think Charlotte has talked about since the 90s. I think 92 this was in front of Charlotte City Council. So it's 2016. We're just now getting these protections. But I think with the momentum happening, you know, it's more hopeful than not because you see folks willing to be more visible and to share those stories. So I'll stop there. I have so much more I could say on this, but I know that it's a scary time, and especially since that has passed. You mentioned in the miscellaneous mini bills, preemption bills are really scary, and they're the scariest. And that, I think, is our calling right now. So I'll share later with you some of the next steps and what we can do to be involved. But just know that the scary times are here because we have folks who are using this issue as a wedge issue, and they know it's an election-ish year. They want to take away some of the power from the municipalities, and they're using us to do it. And, you know, when session starts the end of April, this will be, I guarantee, one of the first bills that will be introduced is how can we stop what's happening in Charlotte? And then how can we stop other cities from doing this? A matter of fact, how can we just not give out these marriage licenses and prevent public accommodations, you know, buying a wedding cake, or going to your hotel, your vacation lodging place? How can we stop all that and take it from same-sex people, couples? Because they're gaining too much momentum now that we have marriage equality. So that's what I'm here to talk about today, and I just wanted to give you some context about what's happening across our state.
That's awesome. I was going to make sure that you had an opportunity to share with us any thinking about how to fight against the backlash that's coming. The game for that great work. Simone, I think that's a great sort of segue, right? You know, you've been in the state house, and so, you know, give us some insight into when something good happens, how your colleagues in the Georgia House would sort of respond and how they make the sausage, et cetera.
All right, cool. So it's really messed up on the inside. Let's just start from that premise. I usually use another word, but I'm trying to get better at that.
You're on camera, girl.
Being on the inside, when I first was elected, I was an activist. I was outside, we were rallying, we were all doing that. One of my biggest disappointments was getting on the inside and realizing that inside the chamber is so isolating that all these years we have been outside marching and rallying, they had no idea we were there. When I got into the chamber and saw that there are no windows, that it's soundproof, we're sitting in a building that was created in the 1800s. So when we're and that the legislators don't even come in and out of the front door where we're rallying, they leave and go out a side door. So unless you are contacting people, your legislators, and saying we're going to be there rallying, 9 times out of 10, they have no idea you're there. So what that mostly turns into is into a media photo op, which is always a good thing because rallying and protesting brings about visibility for the issue. But if you're not going inside of your state house, you're not going inside of your city council. But if you're not going inside of the building and talking to people, chances are they really don't know you're out there. And that can be infuriating because you're like, wait a minute, we put all this time, we made all these signs, arts and crafts, glitter. That stuff takes a lot of time getting together to do. So one of the things we really need to get good at, and we're beginning to get good at it, and we just need to expand it, is going inside of the building. Now, once you get on the inside, there are things that are called decorum. And sometimes it is a challenge to shift from activist language to going inside and talking to a legislator in the way that they require people who are their constituents to speak to them. And it's very effed up. You know, you think, well, I'm a constituent, I'm a taxpayer, I should be able to come in here any dress any way I want to and talk to you any way I want to. That shuts down the conversation. People who have power or who believe they have a certain amount of power really do expect to be approached in a particular way. In Georgia, when we're having lobby days, we ask people, come be nice when you call your legislator, don't go off on them, say what you need to say, and get off the phone or, you know, in the email. I can tell you as a legislator, please don't write me a novel. I need to know within 3-4 sentences, what is the problem, what can I do about it, and what are you asking me about? I'll have time to read a whole novel because I'm reading your letter, and if it's my constituents are really involved because I've kept them engaged, I'm getting 300 emails a day. And all I'm having my legislative aide do is create a file on my computer that says RFRA, and she's putting everything that's RFRA into that file. And I'm saying, okay, today I got 3 letters about an issue. Oh, that's not so big. But I also got 20 letters on an issue. If a legislator gets 20 letters, y'all, that's considered a crisis. Whatever that issue is, because we don't communicate. And we, meaning the whole group of us, all of us, not just the LGBT community, but we don't communicate with our legislators. That's one thing that is done very well on the opposition side is mobilizing. When they put out something and they say, call the governor and let your voice be known, they get together calling parties. We're all gonna meet at the church in the fellowship hall and we're gonna make calls all day long. These are things we have to start doing in the LGBT community as well. I've seen movement happen on bills because of that. In Georgia, this was probably in the 7 years that I've been inside, I have seen more movements come into the Capitol and hold press conferences and lobby than when I started serving in 2009. And it's remarkable and it's heartwarming to see that folks see the state house as the people's house, because that's what it is. Lobbying a legislator can be very scary. Let me tell you, most legislators are dumb as bricks. They are. They don't read the legislation. They have no idea what's in it. We have this idea of, well, how can it be 2016 and you don't know a gay person? You don't know about gay rights. You don't know about transgender issues. You don't know about poor people needing food stamps. You don't know about the working poor who go to work every day and still need food stamps. But if that's not their specific issue, y'all, they really don't know about it. You put energy and time into the things that are important to you. If your issue is not important to them, they don't know it. In Georgia, we have heard so many people say, yeah, well, my brother is gay, but, you know, legislators, my brother is gay, and I'm passing this bill for so-and-so and such-and-such. And it's like, okay, so now you're going to go home and sit down and have dinner with your brother? You know, but 9 times out of 10, they've been homophobic towards their brother all these years, and so it's like, you know, water off of a duck's back. You know, you have to go in there, and you're the expert on what you're talking to them about, right? So if you enter into it that they already know what you're talking about, and you should always go with something in hand. It could just be a postcard, you could just do an email, bullet points. Again, don't write a whole, you know, I know you want to tell your story, but we can't start with way back in band camp. We need to start right at, this is where I want to do, this is the problem, this is how it affects me, and this is how I'd like for you to vote. So always have something in your hand to give to the legislator. And this is how you do it. You approach them, you say, hi, my name is Simone Bell, and I'm one of your constituents. Just want to give you a little information about LGBT rights. I'm a constituent in your district. I am gay, and I would like you to know what's going on. Here's my contact information. Please give me a call if I can help you. Now, they may engage you and say, well, tell me a little bit more about what you're doing. Once you hook them, that's when you go for it. But if you can't get their attention up first, 9 times out of 10, they're not going to be listening to you. You have to, like I said, you have to go in understanding that these are people with egos, and they do want to be held on a pedestal. But you have to go in knowing also that you have an ego, you have rights, and you are a human being. And so you stand up against that wall just like they stand up against that wall. You stand on the premise that you believe whatever it is you're going in there to talk to them about. I would have people who would come and lobby me, and they'd be so scared, and they'd be shaken. And I'm on their side. And they'd be like, oh, I'm like, okay, stop. So everybody take a deep breath. Okay, give me a hug. Okay, start over. And they go, okay. And I'm like, okay, see how it got better? It got better for you, right? Okay, stop, we're gonna do it again. Take a deep breath. And that's something that you just have to practice. And it does seem, I tell you, it seems very scary. But if you go in there knowing your own self-value and your self-worth, and the fact that no matter what they think about it, you are who you were created to be, and you have a right to be there for them to hear your voice. And the more you do it, the easier it will get. You can do this in a state house. You also do this with your city council people. You do this with your county commissioners. All politics is local. So there are some things that are handled on the state level that affect city council, affect county commission. And I realize, y'all, it's a lot of information, I know. But isn't freedom worth the hard work that we have to do? Google is your friend. Google how to lobby. And people friend who can whisper in your ear and say, girl, this is what I heard. This is gonna be in committee tomorrow. Don't tell nobody I told you. Get up at 4 o'clock in the morning, I start reading legislation. I'm at the Capitol by 7, my first meeting is at 8 o'clock. Then I go into the chamber at 9 o'clock. In the chamber, I'm lobbying my colleagues. So I'm on the inside saying, there's this bill, and it's a RFRA. Let me tell you why that's harmful to me and my family. Let me tell you as a lesbian how that affects me, which is why we need people on the inside. No one can have that conversation like I could have that conversation sitting one-on-one next to someone this closely, eating lunch with them, going out for drinks afterwards. So we need to create that bench. Then I lobby, we vote on bills, and most of the bills in legislature, you know, 95% of the bills are just, you know, we can all agree on them. But it's that 5, 10, 15% that's very controversial. So we stay in the chamber probably till about 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock. Then we go to committee meetings, and that's where the work on legislation is really done. By the time it makes it in front of the body for a vote, everybody already knows what they're going to do. That's called a political theater. That's so you can get on record. But in the committee meetings, where you can go in and give, the public can come in and give testimony, that's really important. One of the issues with that is it's really set up as an okey-doke, right? And so sometimes we would find out 2 hours before a committee meeting that the LGBT bill is going to be called today. In 2 hours. Well, folks working at school, taking care of their children, their mama, their parents, all that kind of stuff. So it also sets up a level of privilege that you have to have. And this is by design. I know people are talking about like the whole delegate situation and why does that happen. The framers of our Constitution had no desire for democracy. It was not set up for all of us to be able to vote. That's why people have been fighting for the vote for centuries. It was never set up that way. And so democracy within the legislative process is not set up for the people to be able to engage. And so that committee meeting is so important. Now at Lambda Legal, we get a call. They're like, they dropped the bill. Can we get a legal analysis? We need it in 5 minutes. Beth is trying to save the world on something else. Greg is trying to save the world on HIV. Tara is in South Carolina trying to do this, and it's like, oh my God, we need a legal analysis. And then there's Maggie. Maggie girl, what you doing? I know, girl, we need an analysis in like 15 seconds. We just found out that a bill was going to the board. Then everybody rushes, and when you get those alerts that are coming, usually you go, well, why didn't y'all tell us before? And I'm like, y'all, we didn't know. We're just as surprised as you are. We don't. We up here every day. Y'all, anybody told us? Y'all work with us. So then I go to committee, and a lot of people don't go to committee meetings. So, and that's where the vote is. So things have to, and each state is different, but you have to write a bill. You have to file it. It's got 2 or 3 processes it's got to go through before that. The speaker has to assign it to a committee. Then the chairman on the committee has to decide if it's going to get a hearing. And then you got to kiss that person's behind to get a hearing. And just because you get a hearing don't mean it's going to get a vote. So then you got to sell your soul to somebody else so you can get a vote. And even if you get a vote, you got to sell an arm so that you can have testimony. This is just for one bill, right? So I'm in committees till 5, 6 o'clock. Then I have things I have to do. Everybody wants you to come to reception, come speak about this. We want to give you an award, and that's how they get you. We're going to give you an award. Well, child, I've been working since 4 o'clock this morning. Can y'all email it? I do appreciate it. I'm usually out until 10:30, 11 o'clock at night. Get home by the time I speak to my wife and to my kids. Then I'm back in the bed. Now, that's the life of a legislator, a state and a Senate legislator who is really doing the work. That is not your norm. So I set that up to then show you what people do. You give them a bill. Can you sign up to my bill? What's it about? It's a really good bill. All we're trying to do is make sure that failing schools are doing better. Oh, sure, I'm for that. Then they sign it. If you don't read the words that are on the page, that's what matters, because really what that says is we're going to give the governor the responsibility and the right to turn over public schools to corporate entities and to make money off of children. But see, if I didn't read that bill, and I'm waiting, my friend, you know, she's my friend. She would try to get me in trouble. We go, Lord, I can't fall for it. So anytime someone would ask me to sign a bill, I'd say, I need to read it first. Oh, I don't have time for you to read it. I need to drop it. Then you don't have time for my input on it. So, you know, they learn real quickly. Don't go to her with any shenanigans whatsoever. So that is the tension that we work in within politics. And then you have so many people that are coming at you. So the squeaky wheel gets the oil. And so you have, I mean, these are all cliches, but cliches are cliches because they are the truth. And we try to find new ways to say them. So you have to, so back to the, and that's all lobbying. That's you lobbying me. That's me as a legislator or an elected official lobbying my colleagues. And through that particular process, it's all about educating, right? It's all about transferring information. But the biggest thing that it's about is creating relationships. And that's what politics is about. And that's what she was mentioning when she says, sometimes you just have to go and sit there and listen and roll your eyes. I'm like, well, let's get out of here. The show is about to come on and y'all just talking about anything. But it's about building relationships. And so once you, when you go to Google and you say, how to pass a law in my state, because each state is different, how to lobby my state legislator, people get really focused on Congress, but we need to bring it back home, because what's happening is power is now being situated on the state level, and that's by design. That's been a process that's been happening for 30, 45 years. So people, so like now that we have marriage equality, a lot of people thought that was going to give us full equality. Well, while we were fighting for that, they knew it was coming, and so they were starting to organize around these municipality preemptive bills. So they're like, okay, we'll give y'all marriage, but now we're going to take away every other right you've worked for, and we're going to block you being able to get that, because what y'all wanted was marriage. So since y'all got marriage, we're going to take you out everywhere else. The opposition works with a 10, 15, 20, 30-year plan. In our communities, and this is not just LGBT communities, we tend to work on a 2-year plan. So by the time we get caught up in the game, they're so far ahead, we're not even in the stadium yet. We're still outside trying to get in with our tickets. They have played the game is over, and we're not there. So this is long-term work, and it's hard work, y'all. I'm not gonna lie to you. It's hard, it can be depressing, it can be traumatic, but at the end of the day, it's what has to be done, and we have to be prepared to do the work, because they're gonna stay on their job. And we know that if we stay with it, we know we have wins. Beth just pointed out all of those particular cases where we have wins. Lambda Legal's docket is 51% in the South, and that's the docket over the past 25, 30 years. We win in the South, y'all. People don't believe it, but we do win in the South. When I say we, I mean the communal we. We've been winning. We've been on. Now everybody wants to go, yeah, the South is sexy. Well, y'all come on, because we've been winning. We could definitely use your resources, though, so we can keep going forward. But, you know, and doing work in the South, right, it's like very, it has to be nuanced, right? What works in Alabama and Georgia and North Carolina, you can't bring San Francisco to the South. It's like New York City. We don't want that. So we need people in our area who love, I love the South. I'm a Southerner by choice. I grew up in Detroit, Michigan. My family migrated to the North from Mississippi. As soon as I graduated, I came back South. They weren't happy about it. They were like, we got free. Now you're trying to take us back. But I love the South, and I work hard down here because I know we can win, because we have won. When you go to Google who your state rep is, who your state senator is. You need to know who the governor is. You need to know who the secretary of state is. When Beth talks about voter suppression, the secretary of state who you vote for every year is responsible for that. Now, I'm not gonna ask how many people know who their secretary of state is, or who, if you've ever worked on that particular campaign. We focus a lot on our president, and we might focus on the governor. But the secretary of the state is the one who decides voter ID laws, clerks of counties, they're the ones who do the registration. I've done registration across the entire state of Georgia. When I go down in South Georgia, we try to do voter registration. I've been stopped by the police. I've been handcuffed. I've been told we don't do that down here. The sheriffs of rural counties run the counties, and they stand at polling places with their shotguns, welcoming people in and keeping people out. So when people say, well, people don't go and vote, everybody's not voting because they don't want to. People are being suppressed by tactics. They're being suppressed by laws that are created to make it impossible to vote. We sent a group of young folks down to Butts County, which makes sense because they were a bunch of butts. But Butts County, Georgia, And they were canvassing. The sheriff pulled them over, put the young folks on the curb, took away all their voter registration papers. So then they had access to know who signed up to vote. And so you're in a small town. Think about it. The sheriff runs your town. They know who you are. They're going to just ride by your house real slow, a little bit of intimidation. And the next thing you know, you're not going to vote because you know that they know. So these are the things that we're dealing with when it comes. So if you don't know who your Secretary of State is and you're voting for that person, you need to know what their values are. And some of these positions are nonpartisan, so they don't have to tell you if they're Democrat or Republican. But you can tell by their views most times where they stand on those issues. People don't think about the school board and how important of a race that is. When we need clients and when we're looking for lawsuits, we need to have teachers or administrators who can give us accurate information about what happened on the inside. So something just as simple as who is the school board member is really, really important. Because you want to get people elected who are progressive enough to understand that there are children in our school who are gender non-conforming, who are LGBT. Anything that comes before the Board of Education, we need to make sure that we're considering those issues. If we're not on that Board of Education, who can we trust to do that? And particularly if we haven't lobbied them. Who would even know to say that? Like with the bathroom cases that are going on now, we need to be talking to the boards of education about that. We need to be talking to teachers. We need to be talking to the PTA. We need to be talking to retired teachers. And there are organizations for all of this. So I'm saying all this to say that this is a long game. You have to be visible, and you have to go inside, and you have to know each level of government. And really, you can go online, and it's like civics 101, civics for children, civics for dummies. And you can just figure, you know, go through that particular process and then know what's going on. And once we continue to build that foundation, continue to build that bench, we're going to continue to see our wins improve. Because at the end of the day, y'all do know we're going to win, right? No matter what happens, right? We are going to win. Because people like us and people like you are not going to give up. This is our lives we're talking about. When I spoke before the House, I told them, this is not about a cake. Y'all tripping about a cake and some pictures. First of all, y'all ain't even invited to my wedding. So trying to say, you know, I don't want to be involved in your wedding, you don't even know what color we wear. This is not about a cake. This is about my everyday life. It's about me being able to walk outside and be who I am. And how do I know when I come into your bakery that you're homophobic? Y'all put up a sign and I won't come in there. I tell people all the time, why do you think we come into your church to be married? Child, don't nobody want to get married in a place full of hate? This is a time of joy and love. But people are so fearful about it. But we can do this work, y'all. But we have to do the foundational hard work. And once you do that and learn the process, and you just continue to do the work, and people will start calling you. You're the expert. We need to get in touch with Bonita, because she knows what she's doing. Y'all get Jerome a call over there. Anybody talk to Laura lately? She knows about this particular. And you just offer them your expertise to get through the work. I've seen it happen. I've seen hearts and minds change. I've sat down with so many super religious people, and y'all, they were really upset when they knew I could quote the Bible as much as they could. And I was like, I know what you're saying, but I ain't really what it's saying. They're like, oh, wow, really? I was actually able to change the minds of the Democratic Party in the state legislature, because I approach them, you know, they talk about their family, I'm talking about my family too. You know, why are you always talking about gay issues? Well, why are you always talking about straight issues, right? And so this is why we need to be on the inside. This is why we need to be involved on every level of government. We can bum rush this, y'all. We are intelligent, we know what we need, and nobody can tell your story like you can. So let's continue.
So I'm gonna talk a little bit about